Hey guys, welcome back to Anderson's TV. Danish Pete and I are back in London.
Yes.
At the Gibson showrooms.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah.
Because earlier this year,
yeah,
pre-COVID and everything,
yep,
something magical happened here, didn't it, Mr. Pete?
It did. We came in here to have a look around, and you never expect these things to happen, really, do you? But basically, we were playing loads of guitars in here, and that guitar, which is on the table now, I would say they found me. I like to say the guitars find, the right guitar will find you when the right time is ready. And it just did.
Yeah. We certainly didn't come up with the idea that Pete was going to leave with a guitar.
No.
But we did.
Yeah.
And hopefully you've seen a video now. So we did a video again a while back. Again, I don't think it probably was pre-COVID actually, where we compared Pete's Les Paul.
It was pre-COVID because we didn't have the screen, and I remember. Yeah.
So again, check that video out. We sat on that video for a while because I felt that video needed like a part two of us coming back and trying to understand what was good about this guitar.
Yeah.
So although there's probably in reality about 5 or 6 months between today and when we made that video, but we will have only have put that video up on our channel maybe, you know, a week or so before this video.
Yeah.
Anyway, it is magic, that guitar. Pete took it away. Gibson, I think I vaguely remember, we didn't tell, Gibson came to me like whilst we were here and they went, do you know how much that guitar is that Pete's just taken like that? And like, I don't know.
I didn't even know.
Yeah, Pete, he's like,
we talk about that in the video as well, if you've seen that.
It's the most expensive one here. And it literally was just like, oh no, this could be bad. So we basically, they said, look, borrow it, didn't they, for three months.
And I was like, oh no, but I couldn't not take it.
And Gibson, in fairness, tried to work out the best deal. Anyway, long and the short of it is, you fell in love with it enough to just go, I can't give this back.
I just have to not give this guitar back ever.
So you sold like two of your three children on eBay.
Yeah, which I was going to do anyway, but that money then went to, the guitar.
So now we're back.
Instead of
we're back at the showroom.
Yeah.
We've bought Pete's Les Paul up here. We've also bought my Les Paul.
Yeah. The loser of the video.
The loser of the video. Yeah.
It's not known.
Because I'm still intrigued. There's something. You know, I still had I remember going back 3 years, maybe. Robin Ford played this and told me he thought the one, I think it was the neck pickup, he said was like the best sounding Les Paul.
And it sounded better than the one in his guitar as well.
So we're here today. We are going to spend some time with a guy called Sam, who's been the resident tech here for 14 years.
Yep.
So we'll introduce Sam in a minute. And he is going to take all these guitars to pieces. He's going to micro measure everything about it, pickups. And this was the cool bit that we only just found out a minute ago. Because all of these custom shop guitars go through a Plec process at the end, not only are they able to measure pickups and neck widths and things like that and rebuild it, they're also able to take micro dimensions like nuts, slots and everything and program that into the Plec machine so that when we do start to reproduce this guitar, everything about it will be as exact as it possibly can be. So anyway, look, let's go and meet
Sam.
And
then you can buy one. We'll pick some tops and stuff and you can.
So stay tuned, we'll talk you through the process. So let's go and meet Sam.
Let's do it.
Okay. So this is Sam. Sam's been the resident tech at Gibson London HQ for 14 years. So as well as looking after artists that are coming through town that just need sort of basic setups and repair jobs on the guitars, Sam was also involved at kind of doing this exact process on some of the reproductions you've done on Jimmy Page's Les Pauls, Alvin Lee, James Bay's Epiphone.
Yeah.
So you know, we've got the best guy, basically. Yeah. So take us through, Sam, what are you going to do today on Pete's Les Paul?
So yeah, we're going to measure Pete's Les Paul. We're going to measure the specs on it. So we'll measure the pickups, neck profile, neck depth, have a look at some of the features that obviously make this guitar your pride Les Paul.
Just like, why does that?
And yeah, just basically reproduce what we do on a vintage artist's guitar effectively, which is we just document as much information as we can so that when that guitar goes to a custom shop, they've got everything. You know, we'll do detailed photos. Obviously this is an aged guitar, so there's going to be a lot of handwork that's gone into it. So yeah, any of the significant marks, scratches, stuff like that, we tend to document, we'll measure them. And basically just trying to get a feel for, what makes this instrument a great Les Paul.
Yeah.
Because they're all so, certainly when we do artist instruments, they're all so different.
What's the weirdest thing, not weirdest, but like when you've had artist instruments through, I always think of the story of, you know, Peter Green's Les Paul where the pickup switch is a different setting to a normal Les Paul. What's the sort of, what have you ever, you know, come across and go, wow, that's like, that was hot or cold or?
Yeah, I mean, the biggest one is just packs. The original patent applied for pickups, they're not, none of them are the same. Some of them are really hot, some of them are really low output, and they vary really drastically. And so, obviously we take output measurements from these things, but it may be just one of the factors that changes how a pickup sounds or how a pickup's voiced. I mean, the crazy thing with a lot of the older guitars, certainly, they were kind of modded by people in different ways. We did the Page, his number two guitar. He has two switches underneath the scratch plate for additional wiring options. So he's got four coil taps, not coil taps, four push-pull switches under all the volume parts, which he had on his original Les Paul. But then on the second one, he'd added two more for even more wiring options. And it was the most amazing thing about it was that whoever had done the modification had made this really intricately beautiful copper box underneath the scratch plate that was all soldered together. And it was just the sort of, it's a level of detail and workmanship that you just rarely see. But obviously when you're taking these things apart, you kind of go,
wow. That's cool, isn't it?
Wow. Very cool. Well, let's see what we uncover with this one. So yeah, take it away, Mr. Sam, and right, work your magic.
I will, so I'll start by doing just basic measurements and just start writing down some specs. I might ask you some questions about things. Certainly we'd set up, whether certain things you like, how it plays, that you thought was,
let's go.
Cool,
man.
That is a lovely cavity.
It's very clean.
Yeah, so you've got your Bumblebee caps in there and 50s wiring schematic. So it's all as it would have been. Let's have a read off your pickups and see what kind of output we're looking at.
Here we go. Hopefully you've enjoyed watching the footage of Sam going over the guitar. Spent quite a lot, took a good hour or two, didn't it, to do all that. Pete and I really enjoyed watching him do it. So Sam, on Pete's guitar, which is the one that you did all the main measurements on, can we shed any light as to why we think this one is, one of those like one in 100 guitars?
Yeah, I think I mean, let's start with the weight is obviously the big factor, as we discussed, you know, in terms of wood making a massive impact. Pete's is nearly a pound lighter than yours, which I think you guys kind of already
knew
as a situation. So that will make a big, you know, when you've got this much mahogany in a guitar, it's going to make a big effect on the tone. We've measured pickups on both of them. Again, interestingly, Pete's pickup's a little bit hotter.
Which is kind of...
Well, it doesn't make sense because your guitar was, it's louder.
It's almost like the opposite of what we expected you to say.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, again, this is just going off numbers. So it's hard to really describe the character of a pickup in numbers.
We know the neck profile on that. The neck profile on this is very much what you would expect an off-the-shelf 58.
That's a 58
to feel like. And despite the fact that that is also a 58, that's skinnier, isn't it?
Yeah, the neck definitely is a little bit smaller. As I said, Pete, certainly in the shoulders, the neck profile feels a little bit smaller. So again, you've got a little bit less mass in terms of the amount of wood in the neck than you have on yours. But yeah, I think it's one of those just...
There's some matting in there.
Talk about the potting though, because with your, you mentioned that the pickups on both these guitars have been wax potted. Obviously, would have been done by Gibson because neither Pete or I have done that ourselves. But that currently, the thinking at Gibson on the reissues is to not pot them because that is correct to when they would have originally been built. But to keep this, the reproductions of this guitar as authentic as possible, you'll pot those with you, the Gibson will pot those pickups.
Yeah, we can do it either way. So yeah, they would be potted if you prefer that.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously based on the tone that you're getting out of these, I would say keep it.
We should keep it as it is.
Keep it as it is, yeah.
And you've got all the measurements now so that when that guitar goes through the plec process, everything to do with how the nuts cut and fret heights and all that kind of stuff will be accurate to that guitar as well?
Yeah, so in terms of the setup, the way it plays, I mean, again, both your setups are very different, which reflect your playing styles and players. If we're making a version of Pete's, then obviously we can dial all of this information in. That's the beauty of the plec system, isn't it?
I think that's my kind of feeling is that I still love this guitar and I'm still really happy of it.
You should.
But I don't feel like there's any point in trying to reissue this guitar, because if you want this guitar, you could just go and buy a 58 reissue and you'd get something. You know, obviously you want to try and make sure you connect with it and love it too, but your chances are you're going to get something much the same as this. That one, I don't know.
Yeah, there's something special, but you saw it in the video when you played it. It's like, oh, damn it, it is just, something.
Something
there.
I guess, you know, to a certain extent, maybe apart from the weight, there wasn't necessarily like a silver bullet sort of going, that's what it is.
Yeah.
It is that sort of bit of everything. So I suppose, you know, it's going to be a fun process of putting these together and seeing when they do come through.
Yeah.
You know, do we capture that magic?
Yeah.
But look, super, super cool. Really appreciate your time. Might not see Sam again in this video, so thank you very much for everything you've done.
You're welcome.
It's really, really kind of you. But Pete and I now are going to go and pick some tops. You can see this is about maybe, I don't know, a quarter of the tops that Gibson have got here, so there's a pile of them we can go and have a look at as well. Interestingly for you guys, the tops on both Pete and my guitars are the less flamey tops, so again, more typical of a 58. So we might stick with that, and that'll, good news for you guys, that will actually probably bring the price down a little bit. But if we find a flame top where we're going, oh man, that's the best, and it is one of the flamier, more expensive tops, maybe we'll chuck a couple of those in as well. We're gonna order 10 guitars.
Yep.
So at some point in the next 6 months, hopefully we'll see those guitars in the store, and that'll be the next video, part 3, or whatever this video
is. Oh, the comparison.
Yeah. And we'll do most of them, I think, in the VOS finish. So my guitar is VOS, so it doesn't have any sort of signs of relicking, if you like. Just that sort of slight sheen taken off the chrome pickups, and maybe that slight top surface of gloss just kind of taken off. We'll do some aged through Gibson's sort of, I don't know, what do you call it, like the normal aging team.
Yeah.
And as Pete's one is a Tom Murphy aged one, we'll probably just do one through the Murphy lab. It's going to come out probably not far off of five figures, might even be five figures, I'm not sure. So that's going to be the one for
the special
Danish Pete fan out there that just wants the, you know, as close as we can.
And you know what I'm seeing here? I'm seeing that there's the top here behind me. It's got the little dark bit, which is in my, on the top of that guitar. I don't think you can see it.
But I don't know if you guys can see it. There's a tiny little run in the wood.
Runny wood. I mean, it literally, I saw that. It's like,
honestly, Sam, it's been a pleasure meeting you today.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks for spending the time. It's been great. And yes, let's go and pick some tops.
Let's do it.
So, Pete and I have been through, there's quite a lot of wood in this building.
Yeah. No, Lee likes a bit of wood, but.
And so Pete and I have been through probably 150 different tops. And we've put some of the ones that we liked on the table here and some of the ones we liked on the wall here. Mm. And we're gonna try and narrow this down to 10. But the first one that Pete's doing.
Yeah.
This
guitar has got this very distinct black, or like a little line of, I don't know what that is in the wood. Is that like a grain or something?
It's that's like in a the, in some the wood sort of there? Claw mark or
and
whatever,
we
it?
Found one here, which has got that. And I've put this.
Shall I hold it up?
Yeah, so I've kind of done a little bit of the drawing on it already, but as you can see on the guitar, we wanted to find something that's that kind of vibe, because that is a little distinct mark.
So Gibson, when you make this one, please make sure you use this side facing upwards, not this side, otherwise that would have been a completely pointless exercise.
Well, that's why this is really cool, because we've got this little, what is that?
A template.
Template that you stick on there, and then you see where you want it. Make sure you give yourself a lot of room. I've got a pre-drawn on there ready. And then you literally just go and...
Yeah. If I grab you a jigsaw, do you want to cut it out as well?
And I can
just
do
the whole job for him?
Absolutely. It might look like the air conditioning system though, but...
Yeah, that's true. So that's the first one.
Yeah.
Well, look, that's it. And we'll probably put some music on behind this whilst Pete and I go through them. And you might see this speeded up, because it's quite a lengthy process, isn't it? But I should also tell you as well, so this is something that Pete and I share the opinion on flame tops, although I accept it's completely subjective. Pete and I don't really like those very thin, tiger stripey kind of flames. There's anything wrong with that.
It's really difficult. It's beautiful, but it's too tight.
Yeah, I would say some of the ones we've rejected are even tighter than that.
Yeah.
So we're not going for that. And equally, don't really like quilty ones. So we're going for ones that are quite a slightly wider, perhaps not more subtle. Some of these will be very flamey, but it's like,
I
don't know, maybe
more. Angle, isn't it?
Is it fair to say like a more natural kind of look rather than, there are other guitar brands out there if you want to go for something with ridiculous bling on there, but we're going to try and keep it a little bit more real, aren't we? So, right. Let's go.
Let's do it. Just really quickly to show you, we found another one with this little mark on it. So we're going to stick that on there, find the middle of it, and then see, find that top. I mean, I think this could be potentially... Check this out.
Here's a trick.
Oh yeah, let's
take it off. So this just temporarily kind of makes the... and it perhaps gives you an idea of what the flame might look like once it's lacquered. Ooh, Bob-a-roo!
I mean, that could be the top.
This is just water, by the way, just in case anyone was thinking, how do I get some of that for my guitar? Magic flame juice.
We need this as well. Think about this one, look, Lee, this one here. See the symmetry?
Yeah, I like that.
It's like a Rorschach test.
Yes.
Rorschach redemption.
Okay, put that in the...
Can you just spray me? Do we think that's cool?
Yeah. That is beautiful.
Okay, I'm gonna put that here. That's the one you really like, this one.
Yeah, I think that's, I like that. I like the interesting bit of it. little tip that we got told here as well is, obviously, this is quite a thick piece of maple, and when it's carved onto the top, obviously the edges are carved quite thin. So the thing to do is to look at the cross section of the wood, and this is quite a good example actually of the flame does actually, it's not that pronounced on the cross section of the wood, suggesting that potentially, not definitely, but as you know, this is carved away, this beautiful figure on the top may not go all the way through. So I'm gonna reject that one. So there we go.
There we go.
We have finished choosing our 10 tops. Now the worst bit comes now in that we've just got to wait for, six, 7 months or whatever till we see these guitars. We will choose some colours, some bursts. I think we'll, obviously we'll do this fairly
this
traditional.
What is this one again? I forgot. It's a
heritage cherry.
It's a cherry.
It's just a traditional heritage cherry burst. So we'll do a selection of bursts. I suspect we'll do some slightly darker than that, some slightly more yellowy than that, and some obviously in this red. And I think we'll go for this sort of the dark red back on pretty much all of them. So wowzers!
Oh, I'm excited.
Yes. I don't quite know what we'll do about this. I suspect. We'll ask our web team to set up a page about the visit to Gibson and some of the specs of the guitar, and there'll be like an email sign up on that page, and you'll be able to just say, yep, I'm interested in that, let me know when they arrive or when you get more details on them, and we can do. But yes, what a fun way to spend an afternoon.
Oh, great, man. It's been great. Thank you very much for having us, Scott.
Yes, thank you, Gibson. It's great when you've got this facility in London, so we'd have to fly all the way to Nashville to do this now.
We wouldn't be able to do that now at the moment anyway, would we?
Yeah. Right. Thank you very much for watching. Please like and subscribe. And yes, we will catch you next time. Bosh.